The Connected City Design Challenge is an urban design competition seeking design strategies to connect downtown Dallas and the Trinity River, curated by Larry Beasley and produced by the City of Dallas's City Design Studio. On October 17th, the challenge debuted the design proposals from Ricardo Bofill, OMA AMO, and Stoss+SHOP at the Dallas Museum of Art, with an exhibition on the Ross Avenue Plaza, in concert with the launch of an online gallery of all submissions. Following the opening of the exhibit, the challenge held a jury panel discussion to share and discuss the professional team design proposals and the initial reactions from the jury. The discussion was opened by Dr. Gail Thomas and Dallas' Assistant City Manager Jill Jordan. The panel included jury members Allan Jacobs, Peter Bishop, Robert Meckfessel, and Jury Chair Larry Beasley, and was moderated by the Dallas City Design Studio Director Brent Brown. Special thanks to the Dallas Museum of Art for hosting the discussion. To learn more about the challenge, please visit connectedcitydesign.com.
Welcome. Welcome to this evening. I'm Gail Thomas, and I'm president of the Trinity Trust. I've been asked by the Dallas City Design Studio to greet you and welcome you to this evening. Now, we're here this evening to talk about how we live in Dallas. And I know that you know that over 82% of the people of the world live in cities now. So we have to get it right. In the 19th century, we thought the most important thing we could do for cities was to create infrastructure. Good plumbing, street lighting, garbage removal. The cities had their centers. They already had their centers. We took them for granted. During the 20th century, we thought the most important thing we could do for cities was to connect them to each other, to expand them, and then to move around in them in cars. In doing so, we lost our city centers. Now, in the 21st century, we realize we must regain our city centers. We must create places to be more humane, to be together, to greet each other on the street, to sit next to each other on benches. In essence, to form community, to form trust. We want desperately now to be human beings, once again, in our cities. Walking, sitting, talking, biking, canoeing, kayaking. And we want nature. We want nature because of what nature offers us. It offers us, for one thing, silence. These are human desires. And these human desires demand that we do things differently from now on. So change is coming. Dallas is experiencing an enormous evolution in living styles, a demand for a different kind of city from the one we've known as Dallas, Texas. Some among us, but mainly many of you in the room, the younger generation in Dallas, are changing your living styles. Your living habits. Do our experiences offer the opportunity for a variety of spontaneity? And are we enriched by what we might call serendipitous happenings? Remember that Jane Jacobs says the most important thing about any city is the element of surprise. All of us want to build a great city. We want each one of us to help create a city that is unlike any city on earth. We want to help. We want to serve. We want to make a city that is alive with opportunity, that is nurturing to its people. We want places, intimate places, spaces that feed our souls, that ignite imagination, places that evoke memory. We want neighborhoods that offer safe harbor and hope for the young and, very importantly, familiarity to the old. We want outlets for our entrepreneurial spirits. We want bank loans that support our enterprises. We want corporations that offer jobs and insurance and medical and retirement benefits. And we want CEOs who replace greed with need. And we want governmental and political and civic leadership that inspires us to be greater human beings than we could ever imagine being. Now, I mentioned these social and civic issues because there's one thing that in a city that affects these issues, political, social, civic, economic, and that's really good urban design. In short, we want a great city. And of course, this is what this gathering is about tonight. We've been working on the Trinity River for several decades. We've been working on downtown Dallas for quite a while, over 150 years, the city center. But this project is about connecting the two because we have challenges. We have huge challenges. We're enormously grateful for the creation of the Dallas City Design Studio, and I don't know if Dee Dee Rose is here, but if she is, thank you, Dee Dee. The Dallas City Design Studio has sponsored this Connected City competition to pay attention to and to seek solutions for one of the most difficult challenges Dallas will ever have to face, and that is how to connect the Trinity River to downtown Dallas. So we have an exhibition out on the mall of the museum. It's called the Connected City Professional Exhibit Gallery. And there you can see the professional stream designs. That will be, those designs will be available for view, I think, during the day from 11 to 2, and then on the late nights for the museum. It also is open on Saturday from 11 to 5. Now, the professional stream competition was open to architects and urban designers. 32 submitted qualifications, and the jury, who you will hear from tonight, selected three teams to continue with the design process, and those three proposals are on exhibit. Now, in the open stream, and I mean open, you know, anyone can join, anyone could join, I could, you could, any of you, and we had over 100 proposals submitted. They are available on the website gallery, and that is connectedcitydesigns.com. And are they up now, Brent? Yes, they are up. Now, we have introductions and thank yous. These are in order, so allow us to thank our partners and our sponsors. The Connected City Challenge is produced by the City Design Studio. It is an office of the City of Dallas, as you know, on the ground floor in City Hall, in partnership with the Trinity Trust Foundation, with Downtown Dallas, Inc., and the Dallas Real Estate Council Foundation. And sponsors include these partners, individuals, and area stakeholders and landowners. We have some in the audience tonight, some of our landowners. Thank you for coming. We were talking about you today. And collaborators include AIA Dallas, Greater Dallas Planning, Dallas Architecture Forum, and the Dallas Center for Architecture. And a special thanks right now to the Dallas Art Museum for sponsoring these four sessions here and for helping launch this challenge. So thank you, Dallas Art Museum. Thank you. And thank you to all of our partners. What a thing to give effort, money, support, inspiration, cooperation, encouragement. When we say partners, that is very true in the most profound sense. Now I want to introduce the jury. First, our local jury partners, Linda McMahon with the Dallas, with the Real Estate Council. Linda, stand up, turn around, let them see what you look like. John Crawford from Downtown Dallas. John is not with us tonight, but Dustin Bullard is. And are you here, Dustin? Maybe, there he is, right there. And Mary Cook with the Trinity Trust. Where are you, Mary? She may not be here yet. I know she's coming, but I know Mary Soom is here with the City of Dallas. Mary, you were out there a minute ago. Thank you. And the professional jury panel. Mostafavi is the dean of the Harvard Graduate School of Design, and Mohsen could not be with us tonight. He's the only one on the jury panel who could not be with us. His latest book is Life of Cities. I recommend that to you. The rest of the jury panel is here, and they'll be coming to the stage shortly. Bob Meckfessel, FAIA, here, is the current chair of the City of Dallas Urban Design Peer Review Panel. This is a new peer review panel in Dallas, and I'm eager for you to know more about it. It makes a profound difference and will for years to come for our design in downtown Dallas. He's working on projects throughout North America, Europe, and Asia. And thank you for your service, Bob. Peter Bishop from London. Peter, would you stand and face the audience? Peter is professor of urban design at the Bartlett School of Architecture, University College, London. He has been the first director of design for London. And his major projects are many, but they include Canary Wharf. That's a major project. His book, The Temporary City, is recently released. Allan Jacobs. Allan, stand up and greet our audience. From San Francisco. Allan is the former director of San Francisco Department of Planning. He's had planning projects in the city of Pittsburgh and for the Ford Foundation in Calcutta and many, many others. Many awards to his credit. Books include, and I know most of you in the audience will have his Great Streets. I do. It's all dog-eared. Looking at Cities and The Good City. And thank you for being with us. It's a real honor for you to be with us. And of course, the chair of our jury panel is Larry Beasley. Larry, would you stand? Larry is the urban design advisor to the City of Dallas, and he's the former chief planner for Vancouver. His recent work includes Abu Dhabi and an award-winning plan for the city of Moscow and numerous others. Now, our panel will be moderated tonight by Brent Brown, and most of you here will know Brent. Brent, as you know, is the producer of Connected City. He put it together and produced it. We should all be so proud of your work, Brent, and we are so grateful to you. It's very exciting. And he's also director of the City Design Studio, and he's the founding director of BC Workshop. But before we move to the panel, they will all come to the stage. I want to welcome to the stage Jill Jordan. And Jill is assistant city manager. She's leading the Trinity River project, and she will share our professional submissions, and she will offer her comments before we begin the program. Thank you, Jill.
Good evening. This is a really exciting night for the City of Dallas. We're very appreciative of all of the partners who have put this activity on. Gail, we've been working with Gail for quite some time, and one of the things that she always tells us at the city is that it is important to dream, and I think you're going to be seeing that tonight. We're going to be seeing some very grand ideas, and some of us were talking, you know, how would we actually pull this off? And the important thing right now is to dream and to dream big, be creative. And I think that's what you're going to see tonight. Gail kind of explained the process. So professionals were asked to participate. There was an open stream that anyone and everyone could participate in. The professional stream was shortlisted down to the three firms, and they're the ones whose work we're going to see tonight. So here's the challenge, and here's what we've been working on. Here's the Trinity River, the way it exists today. And as you can see, there's not much out there. You can also see downtown, and there's plenty in downtown, Then you can see the area between the two, and you can see that, well, we have Stemmons Freeway. We have a few other things like the county jail. We have some parking lots. We have bail bondsmen, several liquor stores. But there's not a lot else there to connect downtown to the Trinity. The city has been working on the Trinity, our balanced vision plan, and this shows the balanced vision plan. What you see is right by downtown we have what we call the urban lake. So this is a formal park, if you will, with a big lake water body. We've moved the river channel over. I tried to soften it to make it more natural looking by introducing meanders. We have the natural lake, so a little bit smaller lake with softer edges, lots of wetlands. We have things in here like a skate park. We have an amphitheater, water sports. This is going to be a great place to go canoeing and kayaking because you can put your canoe in at one point, spend 3 hours, and end up at the exact same point. So lots of it's happening inside the floodway. We've got things going on right now. The Continental Bridge is under construction. I was asked about that earlier. Jill, we know it's supposed to be under construction. We don't see anybody. That's because they're working underneath repairing the bridge, and then we're going to put a park on top of the Continental Bridge. We have also started putting the Trinity Floodway trails out there. Our contractor is already laying concrete so that we will have a loop trail all the way from Sylvan down to Commerce with an extension down to the I-30 Coombs Creek Trail. And once TxDOT completes their construction, it will go all the way down to Moore Park. And so the Continental project and the Floodway Trail project will actually open next June. So the city's making progress, and we're bringing people down to the floodplain and to the levees, but we still have this area in between, and the issue is what to do with it. Well, that is the topic of this competition. And the three winning firms that got the privilege and stipend to work on this are these three firms, and we're going to show you their work in just a few minutes. We also had the open stream. Gail mentioned that, 100-plus ideas from a variety of countries and a variety of universities in addition to other individuals. This is like a TV mini-series. This is the first night. There are three other lectures. Each of the firms will be doing a deep dive into their concepts. So, you know, we hope that you will come to all three of the remaining lectures. If time is of essence to you and you don't want to make it all three, pick your favorite one and come to that one. So now for the first firm, and they are Ricardo Bofill out of Barcelona, Spain. This firm, their work has been from all around the world. They've worked in Europe, USA, China, Japan, and India. Since 1963, they've had over 1,000 projects in 50 different cities. This is their submission. They are trying to integrate ecology, transportation, land use, and socioeconomic considerations. One of their big ideas is to build a connection, what they call a D-walk, from the Arts District down to the Trinity, main core of the downtown with the river. And you can see what they're calling the DNA bridge. If you see what looks like the DNA molecule up there, that's a big bridge. They've taken their cues from our local ecology, the Blackland Prairie, and they've used that to help establish the ecological palette for this project area. They are proposing four new riverfront districts, and each of these districts promotes the development around interchange hubs and transportation nodes. Each district would have its own unique design character, and so it would begin to create separate looks and feels for each of those districts. The next firm, OMA, AMO, they have a variety of team members, Mia Layer and Associates, Kevin Sloan Studios, which is a local firm, and I think I saw Kevin in the audience, Mobility and Chain, and RWDI. OMA AMO is an international partnership practicing architecture, urbanism, and cultural analysis. They do buildings and master plans around the world. They are led by six partners, one of whom we know here in Dallas pretty well, and that's Arim Koolhaas. They practice sustainable design. They have offices in Rotterdam, and you'll see that influence in their ideas, New York, Beijing, and Hong Kong. Here's kind of their big idea, and it's actually hard to see in this slide, but in that upper left-hand picture, you see that they've taken our sump areas, and they've really expanded the amount of water that stands in those sumps. And so we knew immediately, they're the ones from the Netherlands, because they understand levees and water. Their submission has a title. It's called Two Rivers and Two Cities. It looks at the zone between downtown and the river as a vibrant linear city. One of the interesting things that they do is they daylight the old river channel. We call them the sumps. Everyone who works with the city tells us we need to change the name of it. But the sump is actually the old Trinity River channel, and it meanders through the Stemmons Design District, the Cedars West area, and actually West Dallas. There's an area right around downtown where somebody a long time ago filled in the river channel, and it no longer exists. And so this idea talks about daylighting the sump area to create a second river, hence the name Two Rivers. So you have the old river and the new river. They are also proposing opportunities to cross I-35. I think all three firms saw I-35 or Stemmons as a major obstacle and a major challenge and how to deal with it. They're calling for new pedestrian bridges on the northern side and the southern side of this project area. They relook at Dealey Plaza and the Houston-Jefferson couplet as gateways to go from downtown to the river. They are proposing a chain of cultural venues and outdoor amenities to establish a central spine through the project. And they also are calling for a whole chain of what they call urban islands, stretching from Rock Island to the Design District. And each of these urban islands has its own unique programming mix. The next firm, Stoss+SHOP, they have a local partner. Grisham is their local partner, and I saw them in the audience tonight. Also participating on this team is Nielsen Nygaard, James Lima, and Burrow Happold, ETM Associates, and Limnotech. Stoss+SHOP, they're landscape architects, urban designers. They focus on city making, urban development, and social space. They are committed to high density and innovative urban projects that are tuned to and shaped by environment and real estate strategy. They're trying to create vibrant, socially and culturally rich urban districts from sound landscape and development principles. They have work across the United States and North America. They have entitled their submission, Hyperdensity, Hyperlandscape. What they are proposing is essentially three dynamic mixed-use neighborhoods interspersed with regions of landscape and park areas, a kind of forest, if you will. They expand the city grid towards the river, and they green over the river towards the city. They are focused on wetland filtration, wetlands, public spaces, gardens. They're also proposing light rail along Riverfront Boulevard. So there's no way that a few comments can do justice to these massive ideas. And so at this point, we're going to bring up the jury and let them do a deeper dive into the three ideas. So thank you all.
Thank you. Excellent, Gail. Thank you. So good evening. My name is Brent Brown, and thank you all for being here. Right before we get started, and Jill mentioned we have some members of the teams in the audience, and I'd like to acknowledge them just very briefly. Ricardo Bofill, who is here with the team, Ricardo Bofill, Ricardo, stand for us, please. Where I'm oh, right here. Yep. You're sitting right behind me, I apologize. In addition, Kevin Sloan Studio with the OMA team. And Alex Martinez with Grisham, which is a member of the Stoss+SHOP team. So the way we are going to proceed with an opportunity to talk about our professional stream ideas. Outside in the gallery, these ideas, and Jill, thank you for your remarks and helping to shape and position then, I think, what these gentlemen adjacent to me will begin to speak about. We're going to hear briefly from our jury members that are here on the stage with me, and then followed by that, we're going to open it up to the audience in the conversation as soon as possible. We want to move to that. So with that, I'm going to ask each of them to begin, and Bob, would you mind starting? Thank you.
Thank you, Brent. Well, it's a pleasure to be here, and it's a treat to see so much good work and so many good thoughts. We've only had the projects available to us for a few days, and there's a lot to absorb in them, and we're still absorbing them. So my comments are going to be at not even 30,000 feet, more like 30,000 miles, looking down at these. Very much first impressions. But a lot of us in the local community that have been involved with the Trinity have been involved with the Trinity since 1998. So we've been looking at this for 15 years. And one of the ongoing comments and questions is, you know, how do we get across the dozens of transportation lanes, not just 35, but train tracks and the riverfront boulevards, so on and so forth. And what I'd hoped to see, and we have, is really some fundamental insights and different ways of thinking about this that these three schemes represent in very different ways. I mean, the three projects or the three proposals are very different. Just a couple of the intriguing insights that I took away from them is one, which was the OMA scheme, and I'm not judging any qualitative, making any qualitative decisions yet, or at all. I'm just commenting, but that the OMA observed that the levee, the top of the levee, which we've always perceived as a barrier, is actually even at the same elevation as downtown Dallas, and I think that's an intriguing. It's kind of one of the, well, duh, but none of us thought about that, and they did. And I think it's an interesting revelation and insight, and it informs their scheme of really creating two levels, one down at the river and one up at the city, and an interesting way to think about how to organize that. The Stoss+SHOP scheme, on the other hand, really turned that around, turned around the idea of the city reaching out to the Trinity and said, well, why can't they reach out to each other? And I think that's an intriguing idea. And there's one little diagram in their solution which does this. And I think that's a fascinating insight. Each of the schemes has a different reliance on major amenities. Some of them are stress museums, biodomes, maritime museums, so on and so forth, more than others. That's a little bit of a concern to me because, as I mentioned today, it took us 10 years to build one science museum. So thinking about building 8 or 10 of those just makes me tired. But that's not all that's there. What was particularly intriguing to me, though, was the way they each dealt with the landscape and water. I'm including water within that. Like I said, the Stoss+SHOP scheme had fingers of the river reaching out to the city as fingers of the city reached out to the river. In what appeared to be a fairly natural kind of urban forest sort of concept. OMA had the two levels, one with the, that was the lower level, was intensely water driven. As Jill said, it looks like it made sense that it came from the Netherlands. And they had some intriguing, smaller detailed ideas like repurposing Dealey Plaza as part of that, which I think is a really intriguing idea. And then the Bofill scheme really put the traffic lanes in an urban forest running parallel to the river, which I thought was just a completely different way of looking at it. That was intriguing. But we can talk all night, but the main the main thing I was struck by was how, as we talk today among ourselves, the jury and several other people, how the implications of what is in these boards and what are in these solutions about the, connecting the Trinity to downtown, the implications at much broader urban issues and much broader issues that our community are facing are great. And as much as anything, they start, that to me, started making me think about ideas that could be taken elsewhere in our city or extended up and down the Trinity beyond just the immediate study zone. There's some really big implications and ideas here.
Thank you, Bob. Alan?
Thank you. Nice to be here. It's lovely to look at things, and I think that the one thing that struck me as much as anything else, maybe a little more, and I think it was the Stoss people, and it's what I would expect with from a team that had Nelson Nygaard with it, to do a real traffic assessment, not to really understand that most of the people who are on the freeways around here aren't coming to downtown or, you know, to Dallas. They're going beyond. And that requires some, and really suggests, some strong alternates. And I think that's really important, very, very important. It's a good regional-based approach. It's long-term, faces the long-term, and directly gets the city into understanding that they've got to do something in time with the freeway spaghetti that you now have. The dense housing near the river. There are a number of teams that have that, and some of that is quite good, quite promising. The landscape penetration of the one team that brings strong arrows into the city, as well as bringing out from the downtown development at reasonable scales. Reasonable scale, it's not just one road coming out, but a number of roads that make honest connections and can be urban neighborhoods in reality. The forest, really planting, that is so large as part of the Bofill study proposal to deal with, one way of dealing with all of those freeways, is important. And if you take that far enough and think about how you could really do that in new ways, think about that in terms of growing big time trees, of agriculture within them, of employment within forestation, then it begins to be exciting stuff. The understanding of the river, that is more than one team, and of water, I found very promising. Thank you.
Very good. Peter.
Once again, thank you. Delighted to be here. And in the course of the last few days, I've bounced between the three schemes and been alternatively convinced by all three of them in different ways, but they are different. And suppose for me, there are four things which have intrigued me about the different approaches. The first is connectivity. It is about connection. And each of the three proposals take different approaches to how you connect the downtown area to the Trinity River. For me, in looking at it, there are a number of key things in connection. First of all, there's the water's edge. If you are putting a new toll road, a turnpike in there, do you retain it, do you cover it, do you expose it? And there are different approaches to that. The second thing about connection is how do you anchor it into your downtown area? And where do you anchor it? And in particular, connection is about a journey. And I've been very interested in trying to imagine what that journey would be like through the three different schemes and the experience of it. And those journeys only ever happen if you're convinced those journeys are worth making. So that's the sort of second thing. The second element is one of urban form. And again, I think what has intrigued me are two quite different approaches to urban form. You do look for a very, very clear, robust concept of what this new piece of city will look like. OMA and Bofill have both taken, into loosely a linear form, which takes the water's edge as the determinant of the new piece of city. Stoss and SHOP have taken a very, very different approach, very much by driving these green wedges in, these landscape edges in, and producing three development nodes, quite different places. And there's a very, very interesting debate, I think, for this city about which form is the most appropriate. And intriguingly, which one might set up a set of challenges over the next 20, 30, 50 years as the kind of growth this city might have and how it might be formed. The third element is around landscapes, and my colleagues have mentioned landscape. I suppose one of the distinguishing things about urban design is actually space. It's the space between buildings. And generally speaking, that can be very, very difficult. And I've been very interested in looking at the ways in which the different teams have approached space and looked at the function of that space, the design of it. Is it informal? Is it formal? Is it manicured? Is it managed? Is it productive? Is it water? And each of the projects are taking different proposals, and in that they'll create quite different places and different experiences. Then the fourth element is around can we actually implement these? There is an awful lot of development being proposed in all three of the schemes. It's a very, very large area. So I suppose the question for me is that if you were to do a part of it, what would be your first move, and how would that first move convince everybody to make the second, the third, and the fourth moves? And then there's a fifth thing, and the fifth thing, I suppose, is delight. One of those highly technical words we never use enough. Delight, enjoyment, beauty. Both as a single place, as a set of places and neighborhoods, and as a set of experiences that you'll have as citizens as you move through these spaces, which will convince you it's worth moving through them. So I think there's a fantastic debate here. We have three schemes which actually are posing the questions and the challenges, and I really look forward to seeing how you respond and how we get that debate moving and the kind of outcomes.
Thank you, Peter. Larry.
Well, if you have ever felt despair in this area, and I have to say, as a visiting urban designer advising this city, I have felt despair in this area, especially when I've seen the amazing improvements in the downtown, and I see the wonderful dream of the Trinity, and realize how far apart these things are and what's in the middle. If you have felt that despair, you won't need to worry about that anymore. If there's one thing that I have learned from seeing all three schemes, is that this is a huge opportunity for Dallas. It's not a problem. It's an opportunity where you have big land masses, a few land owners, one of which, by the way, one of the most important landowners we don't think about is TxDOT itself and the city,
You have open potential for development. Many cities are struggling with having that potential, et cetera. And all three schemes confirm some things that really start to show a direction for the city when you get serious about designing this. For example, all three schemes confirmed that somehow you have to cope with the freeway system, and it's not by Boston burying it or denying it, it's by trying to do something with it. Second, all three schemes, and I'm taken by their similarities as much as by their differences, all three schemes talk about development as a scenario to drive the change. I have worked in other situations where landscape is the answer and is often seen to be, by public agencies, the most obvious answer because they control that, they control parks and that. Well, all three schemes are talking about development, and they're talking about it in districts, and they're talking about it connected by transit, and they're talking about it being walkable development at a scale that is walkable, and they're talking about density. And they're placing it where there is land to develop. And so that sets for me up a sense of opportunity that if we can have the city working with the landowners, you can do something with that. And then all three proposals have a strong landscape strategy. It's not like you often see, the other thing you often see is that the landscape architecture is what's left over when you finish the architecture, and any landscape architects in the room know this. But instead, in one way or another, whether it's Bofill, who is really talking about ecology and reestablishing ecology around the whole freeway system, or Stoss+SHOP talk about injecting landscape in major, major swaths back into the city, or OMA with this absolutely intriguing notion of waterscape, which is a part of landscape, being the form giver and the personality for this new part of Dallas. All of them have strong landscape and with that ecological propositions. Not one of the schemes, in my opinion, is implementable. They are really big ideas. And if there's one thing I learned from asking for big ideas, is that there's a kind of a dichotomy that we're going to have to face. That is, the big ideas, which are there and are relevant, are 3 and 4 lifetime implementation propositions, and in the hundreds of billions of dollars. And so with that has to come the alternative, which is the accretion of many hundreds of small ideas that ultimately will drive to those big ideas. And what I was really confounded positively about was to have it confirmed for me that there are those incremental ideas that are relevant, that make sense, that will move in the right direction, and that you can see here. And so it's going to be very interesting, both as the public reacts, but for me also as the professional community assists the city and the landowners in the next few years, to begin to take those ideas when you have demand, when you have investment possibilities from bonds and other things, focus them so that each of the pieces will be a coherent whole by itself, but by the same token, over a number of these initiatives and many years, it will come together as something a lot bigger than just incrementally some things happening. And that's really what these schemes show. And I think what it's going to help us do, the professional, the design community that's going to work on this for the next few years, is tell you which of the propositions make sense and which propositions might be tabled don't make much sense, and where we can get moving. For example, when you've got a pile of land and you've got people willing and interested, I think you do have the potential to build genuine new demand, a new profile of demand in residential, which ecologically could be very balanced at the river with the job the fact of a lot of jobs in the existing downtown, in mixed-use schemes linked with the various umbilical cords. And that will be then almost like more of a system of growth rather than a master plan of growth. And that's what's very intriguing by these. Each one of these shows a system of growth that you can, in fact, implement. Now, occasionally, and Ricardo is a big thinker and shows us this wrought large, you see a linkage, and in fact, all three schemes do this, that is, you know, several billion dollars to do. And we'll have to see whether Dallas has the oomph to do that, because if it does, it could be quite amazing. But just as occasionally with every scheme, you'll see where one developer, one landowner, working with the city in a collaborative arrangement, could make one of those linkages. And ultimately, there could be 50 of those linkages. And ultimately, it will be the fabric that pulls it all together, because when you establish something here and it wants to link to something here itself, naturally, they are going to find a way to link. It's not going to be you have to push it. It's you're going to have to fend off the linkages in the end. And I think that's what's so amazing about these. So as you look at them, and I hope you will, and I hope you vote on them, these ideas, really be thinking about how you could take one of these bold moves and you could bring it to ground tomorrow, this generation. I'll give you one final proposition. All three schemes have this amazing potential with landscape that Allan Jacobs mentioned. If you added a sense of business to that equation, as Allan has suggested, you could probably implement a profit-making landscape there within 5 years. You could take the land that's owned by TxDOT, if nothing else, don't worry about the private land, and you could have garden, you could have harvest, you could have profit-making activity going on there, and at the same time, grow the green, grow the trees, provide the moderation between the image of the freeway and the development potential. That, to me, is really the genius of these proposals. They're big ideas, and they're small ideas.
Excellent. Thank you, Larry. So I'm going to ask for the lights to be brought up just a little bit, if we could. And everyone, I know that the container is small, but I'm hoping you got a chance to glance at these better than maybe just what we were able to see here. And I really would like for you, based on these comments, to think about what question you'd like to pose or comment in the case of what we've heard from our four jury members that are with us. But as to get that started, what I'd like to do, you know, Peter, you brought up about these 5 points and within it implementation, right? Larry's made some interesting propositions about how we can get to work on things, right? So we can have the big idea, but how do we get to work on it, right? Bob, both of you have all made these sort of similar comments. And maybe we take just a minute and respond to that as the audience, and I'll be watching for a hand, and then we'll get right into that, if we could. But really, while we have big ideas and boards and things that we're working towards a dream of a city for decades and generations, it's how we can also go to work tomorrow, possibly. So, anyone first on that?
Well, I think that a couple of the schemes, you could get to working. It isn't tomorrow. You could begin to detail out tomorrow on the housing development, especially on the lower, as I look at it, eastern edge, to begin to think about development along the river there. There are opportunities to do that, and then to do it, but then to really establish the right scale to it. You know, it was a result of our discussions this morning that I got to thinking about, whoa, what are the things you could do with the stuff around the freeways, with all that, I'm sorry, all that spaghetti. And, you know, you can bury it, you can hide it, it's going to be there. But I've also seen too many places where you could really do some exciting things. When I say trees, I'm not talking about them just to make a nice forest. I'm talking about them as a cash crop. I really am. And when you think about, people have to take care of those, by the way. And they earn some money doing it. And they grow faster than you might think. And you get to the point where you can harvest them. You harvest them in time. I remember there was a time, by the way, in Beijing. After World War II, China had almost no trees. It had been bereft of trees taken out. And in parts of Beijing, along some major routes, they planted, I have pictures of them, trees. And it was interesting about the trees, they were all different. There were one row one size, one row another size, another row higher size. And those were cash crops. They needed wood. Well, it's not so crazy to think about landscape that way, to say nothing of the possibilities of growing food in some of this property, which are pretty huge, which you went through pretty big. Well, I'll leave it go with that for now.
I'd add to that. This next few years, you are definitely going to be dealing with the sumps. You have bond money. You have an agenda for that. I agree with Jill that they shouldn't be called sumps anymore. They should start being called something else. Because when the competitors went before they submitted and they were on the site, the single most visual impact that caused their commentary was, wow, look at what the green that's already there. Look at the water that's already there. I think if you began to think of not just the flood control that must be achieved through the system, but also the recreational and potential, and also the ecological potential, and also the urban setting that they could give as well, and start a multi-agenda design program for those, I think you could reframe that whole thing quite quickly. And if you do that, you will raise the value of the lands that are nearby left for development. There's no question of that in my mind. And that, along with the potential of the Trinity itself, then I think creates a kind of a place in the marketplace for that development, which makes it preferred to other investments that you might see elsewhere in Dallas over the next few years. And you need five or six of those before you have a movement of development that creates a place. But you could set it off, I think, with that rethink of the water. Because OMA's on to something. Now, they have made some technical mistakes, we know that. But I think they're on to something about the use of that water as a image giver and as a value giver for the area.
Excellent. Peter?
I think the question, where do you start and how do you make your first steps? You have two really difficult problems here as a city. First of all is how do you create a place where you don't have a place at the moment? And if that's difficult, the more difficult thing is how do you persuade people to want to use it? In other words, how do you change the patterns of use that citizens make of this city? And that's a really, really big challenge. I think in approaching that, there are a number of ways in which you can start. And we've talked about landscape. And landscape's very, very powerful because actually landscape is relatively cheap. And it does produce a framework. It produces a chassis upon which you can actually build urban form and frame it. And that's a very, very powerful thing. I think the kind of conversation for my colleagues about landscape is a really powerful line to pursue. The second thing is destination. And you are doing work to the Trinity River. And I think that I look forward to coming back to Dallas and actually going out in my kayak and actually enjoying this this new resource. But actually, it probably takes more than that. I think it's a very interesting development in urban design, where we're becoming as interested in managing and curating space as in designing it. I think it's a kind of issue here for the city as to how do you make this water not just a beautiful design space, but really make it a very, very exciting destination. And then the next thing for me actually is outside the site, because this will not be a destination people will come into unless you really think about the edge of the downtown area beyond the dotted blue boundary. And how does that work? And how do you make the downtown area, especially the streets and the spaces, part of a complementary approach that persuades citizens to walk, to cycle, and to move across these spaces, and you get that kind of linkage. Then finally, within this kind of developing strategy, maybe there's one thing, there's one extraordinary, amazing thing you do that people talk about and go and see. It could be an event, it could be a building, it could be a piece of landscape. I don't know what it is. I don't think anybody yet knows what it is. But I think that when you start to try and persuade people to use cities in a very, very different way and change their very entrenched habits, you need something that's so extraordinary that people go back and they want to experience that again, and they talk about it and persuade other people to do it.
Peter, thank you for bringing up the boundary, the little blue dotted line. And a note to make is that all three teams chose to break the boundary. Now, I don't know that we're surprised. Architects, planners, urban designers like to break those rules, and they creatively done it. So since the lights are up, we've heard some remarks from our jurors here. Questions from the audience? Yes, sir, right here. And I'll...
this is the second seminar I attended today. I went to a seminar at SMU today on the future of transportation in Texas. And the bad news, sir, is that they want to make more spaghetti freeways and they want to monetize them. So I can sum up that whole seminar, that very long seminar, with four different panels. And every one of them was 90%, where are we going to get the money, and 10% vision. And I'm hoping the vision is going to come from you guys, okay? And my question is, how do you integrate transportation into design in an artistic way?
So did everyone hear the question? Let me just repeat it based upon the interest of the future and the current dialogue in a seminar today that was attended around new transportation demands and infrastructure. How do we integrate that into design? I think the question goes to, you know, how do you do it? It's not just always about the what, but it's about the how. And so I think it's very, very relevant beyond just what we're seeing from the teams, but from jury discussion today about, and you see this to some degree, within the board. So I'm going to, Allan, do you mind stepping off first?
You know, I'm probably the only guy here who went to the 1939 New York World Fair. You know, and saw that great exhibit, the General Motors exhibit, that fair. You got to see whatever that was. We went around and saw all this wonderful stuff with the automobiles and the cars were working. They were just wonderful things, you know, and that helped kill America. I'm not kidding. That really did us in with replaced transit all over with all these wonderful highways, you know, and it wasn't so good. So I'm cynical, skeptical. On the other hand, I'm thinking about what you could do. It isn't craziness. I don't think it'd be crazy to design, and I'm really responding to what you could do right away, sort of thing. I don't think it'd be crazy to design a really good, moderately direct bike path from downtown to the river. A really good one.
They talked about that.
What? Well, I'm sorry, I'm not hearing you.
So the comment from the audience was that they did talk about that today. Excellent.
Great. Put trees all along it, make it a great place to be. They'll grow fast, people will care about them. Put something down there in the river to be at, and then go back. You know, be getting some movement in there to, you know, that connection.
But I think you deserve an answer that gets to the heart of some of what's happening. I think Texas is still putting too much of its eggs in that basket of expanding that auto system. There's a truth. On the one hand, personal mobility is here to stay. If anyone tells you that personal mobility is on its way out or its peak oil is causing people to start to shift, all they have to do is go to Abu Dhabi or Delhi, where the first thing that people will do when they got money is go into personal mobility. And they do it before housing and they do it before healthcare. So it's here to stay. By the same token, what we've done, and I agree with Allan Jacobs on this, is that we put all of our eggs in that and we haven't done the alternatives, because we now know from many modern cities that whole big portions of the population, either because they can't afford it or they're not interested, would prefer the alternatives, and we haven't invested in the alternatives. Transit, walking, cycling, the whole thing. And smart cities, as fast as they possibly can, are shifting money. They're putting among planners and designers, it's called putting the roads on a diet, and they're shifting the money over to building that other infrastructure. They're not saying no roads anymore, but they're trying to add the rest of it in. And it comes down to often changing the actual design of that next alignment that you're doing. Instead of saying we're going to apply the freeway system to that next element of that transportation system, you say, no, we're going to accommodate cars, but we're going to accommodate this and that and the other and accessibility, and we're not going to deny the value of land adjacent to this by virtue of not giving access and all those issues. In other words, there's going to be many, many interests served by that design exercise. And that's really, you know, I'm a child of Allan Jacobs and his method and his books, and that is the one truth that I learned that I could also implement, which is, the next road, just design it differently. Design it in a humane way. Don't argue the battle that no one's going to need roads anymore, because I just personally don't buy that battle. But also don't say that you don't need all the rest of it. And once you add sidewalks and bikeways and trees and intersections and accessibility and public art and landscape and fountains and all the other things that make beauty and that bring joy, it'll look better, and it'll work better.
I think, you know, pretty endorse what Larry has said, and Allan, but I want the keys is not to be scared. And I think one of the dreadful legacies of 20th century infrastructure engineering is that we have engineered out the diversity of use of our infrastructure. We've used design specifications which take up too much land. We've tried to segregate the pedestrian, the cyclist, the motorist, and we've killed off large parts of our cities. I think we can design our cities in a far more efficient way, a far tighter way. We can, to an extent, humanize even quite large freeways. A lot of the more interesting work I've seen in cities across the world has been to actually take quite busy highways, turn development to front them, put in sidewalks, allow at-grade crossings, make the vehicle stop, slow the traffic down, remove guardrails, and actually accept that there's a degree of coexistence you can have which allows the city to use space a lot more efficiently than the kind of engineering geometries we've imposed in it on it in the last kind of 50 years.
Thank you, Peter. Yes, right there.
Yes, sir. I think the gentleman in San Francisco has a great idea. He says the tollway that's going down the Trinity River may be a highway for people passing through to other destinations. And I think he has a good idea in taking a transportation count of where the cars go and then build the highway rather than build the highway to make the cars go there. I think Ricardo Bofill said that he had been taking concrete installations in Europe and taking them down and making parks out of them. Here we're installing a turnpike in a park. And as I said last time, I don't want to break my arm and leg going through four lanes of highway to get to the park.
So I was wondering if Ricardo's dynamite part of his lecture would be brought up tonight. I remember Ricardo very excitedly talked about dynamite last time he was here. So we'll look forward to Tuesday night and see if we're moving from dynamite to maybe trees.
This is not just about the tollway. There is already several thousand acres of your downtown that is already freeways. Put aside the tollway, whether you decide or not, your business. You've made your decisions, or maybe you'll change your decisions. But you've got huge dedication. You have 80% of the people in that system going somewhere other than downtown. They don't care about downtown. They're zooming through. And you spend 40% of all of your land of downtown accommodating them. And it is, by the way, the most valuable land in the whole region. It's right up there with the most valuable land in the whole region. It's not good urban land economics to take your most valuable land and use it for that one single purpose. It's kind of like taking my view of, you know, Vancouver's beautiful mountains and water and putting the bathroom there. It shouldn't be. It should be the living room, right? And that, to me, is about what can you do over time to start to bring down the amounts and of land dedicated to this one use. And when you can't, and sometimes you can't, then you have to go with the design solutions and treat it in a different way. There's another thing that Allan Jacobs, my tutor, says, and that is, in a perfectly functioning transportation system, no one gets everything they want. Everyone, whether you're the driver or the cyclist or a pedestrian or whatever, you're going to compromise because you have to do one thing. You have to coexist. And once you design to coexist, it's going to look totally different. It's going to feel totally different. And it's going to function totally different.
That's just one of the things I talked about, I know, earlier today with staff. The way we got some major projects through that with, you know, really people at each other and all the rest of it was working with them, but we're doing the design. Nobody gets everything they want. Everybody gets a lot. Those get to be the working words. And you say it over and over again. Nobody gets everything you want. Everybody gets a lot.
I just, I mentioned in my early opening comments that, you know, some of the thoughts and some of the conversation about the three schemes that we had this morning among ourselves and with the rest of some of the other jurors and staff and others offered implications about other parts of Dallas and other ways to view parts of Dallas besides just the Trinity. And I think Larry's absolutely right. You know, the parkway or the tollway or whatever you want to call it is a small piece of our problem, if you perceive that as a problem. It's still a small piece of the bigger problem, which is, you know, we have Stemmons Freeway there. That's you know, even if we didn't build the tollway, we still have a problem connecting to the Trinity. But what's intriguing it to me is that three out of the four sides of downtown right now are kind of in play from the highway standpoint. On the west side, we're talking about the tollway and the parkway and what to do with Stemmons. We have the Horseshoe and the Mixmaster being rebuilt on the south side. And there's a very intriguing idea of taking down, well, TxDOT has said they need to rebuild the elevated on the east side of town, 345. Mm-hmm. And there's a very intriguing idea being floated around town about taking that down and looking at a broader system-wide solution that doesn't involve elevated freeways that cut off Deep Ellum and East Dallas from downtown. So I think as a community, it behooves us to take some of the challenge that the OMA scheme and the analysis gives to Dallas and extend that across our, not just this quarter, but the entire ring around downtown. Really, the only place we've got the freeways right now is on the north side with Woodall Rogers, because we buried it and just built a wonderful park on top of it. And that's the only thing we got right. But everything else is in play.
I'm also anxious, even tonight, but period, that people may not notice that the real solutions for a lot of these issues that are shown in these three proposals that are before us are not about changing the movement pattern at all. It is about development. All three schemes endorsed intensive development near the water. All three schemes endorsed diverse mixed-use development close to the water. And all three schemes particularly talked about residential development, noticing that your downtown has now, someone told me today, less than 10,000 people living there. Calgary, Alberta has 37,000 people already. Toronto has 220,000 people, and New York has 500,000. If you want to be a great city, I think you have to use this opportunity in these great sites on the water to develop these kind of mixed-use districts or communities. I think someone called it the DWOC districts. I think that was Ricardo Bofill. To engender something that you will not otherwise ever have, and that's simple proximity. If you want to deal with volumes, if you want to deal with capacities, someone said to me one time, instead of building another freeway, what could we do? Take the same volume, the number of people, you're going to serve 100,000 people a day, build 40,000 housing units right next to the jobs, and you won't have those people in the commuter rat race. They will instead be walking to work. In my city, which went from 35,000 to 110,000 people in little more than 15 years, the number of people on the roads coming in and out of town has gone down by 30%. Down. That means we are now removing infrastructure. We're taking left turn ramps that took 4 or 5 acres, and we're turning them into just a left turn in a normal street system with a left turn bay, and opening up 4, 3.5 to 4 acres for urban development, which is some of the highest priced development in our country, in my country. So, you know, I really like that we see development propositions here. And I have to tell you, I really like that some of our sponsors are landowners that could do that development. We have to help them build the demand side. They've got the supply side dealt with because they will build development. But we have to help them build the demand side. And that's all the things that Peter was talking about before. It's the quality, it's the placeness, it's the enticement, and all of those things. And I'm convinced that that's really how these issues are going to be solved in the longer run future. If you can get yourself to the place where you have 150, 175, maybe 200,000 people living in downtown Dallas, you can actually start taking apart the freeway system that's separating the city from the water. Not in any kind of drama, but because people will demand you use that land for something better, because it'll be very, very valuable. It's just so important that we not lose track of the development proposals that are in this. And you know, you can add all the social agenda into that. You can have low-income housing, middle-income housing, family housing. You can have jobs and housing in the same building, lofts, the creative class. This is all the agenda of contemporary smart development that is enabled by these schemes.
Thank you, Larry. Yes, there.
I had a question that I wanted to expand on that Bob touched on just a little bit. You said something about taking the links down other paths like rivers I think he had mentioned that. You mentioned going down other paths. So you've got Cedars West and the Trinity Trail and the Trestle. You've got the arts, you've got the design district, you've got the Trinity Trail. You know, we've opened up, say, Moore Park on the south side. Are you proposing to maybe take some of these, for example, Cedar Creek, and take those creek trails and link those into what's happening as well?
I'm trying to remember the comment you're referring to. Well, I don't have any specific proposals. I mean, I certainly think the more interconnection we can get among our budding trail system, the better. And the more places we can link that over the levees and across the levees and across the river, certainly that is to be commended and encouraged. I may have been, the thing that the linkage to me was really, we have traditionally, it's always been thinking of building some kind of bridge, and I don't mean literally a Margaret Hunt Hill Bridge, but somehow bridging from downtown to the Trinity, from the CBD to the Trinity. And a couple of the schemes are, literally almost do that, like the Bofill scheme has a DNA bridge. But the others, I think particularly the Stoss+SHOP scheme, actually extends the grid out, in three places. The city grid goes out, not as a single slender element, but it takes a chunk of the city and extends it out. And I think that's something that has really not been thought about or discussed much in our conversation over the past 15 years here. I think that's what I was trying to say.
I think your reference also to the datum line between the levee and downtown and the way those two elevations are being considered, I think it's in the OMA scheme, where the landscapes and the buildings and how that starts to relate. And that was another comment, just to add.
Remember the Bofill scheme too talks about linear linkages out of the open space system right into the existing downtown using streets and greenways, in other cities generally called greenways, to entice the movements.
And that was that D-walk that extends back to the Arts District and really connects existing assets and tries to create that link. So, yes, sir.
But to me, the more I think about it, as we're here, I think more and more things that you could do early or get started early would indeed be housing right up by the edge of downtown facing the Trinity, but up in that area where you started there. I understand the other opportunity by the river, but for sure, because downtown really needs something. It's your downtown. I'm less than a newcomer, and I've been walking around the area. And I hate to say it, but it's only a little bit better than walking around downtown Kansas City.
At least it's a little better, Allan.
It's better.
It's a little better.
But that ain't no good. I was in Kansas City, and the primary thing that I saw on every street, every block, was two parking garages. It ain't a hell of a lot different here. I'd start something, and they began doing housing in Kansas City, bless them. And I'd start putting housing right up in there.
I saw a couple of other questions, so go right here and then back to Annie. So, yes. Let's let her go first, please. Thank you.
Each team has shown many different ideas at many different scales. Which idea or ideas surprised you the most?
Okay, so the question was, there's many ideas from many of the team, or for all the teams, and which ideas did you find most surprising,
unexpected?
So where was something unexpected? Great question. So who wants to start?
Linda McMahon today had the same comment that the and I keep going back to this, but the fact that the levees in downtown are at the same level was just one of those aha moments, and that they built a scheme around that. You know, this, what do they call it? What was the name of this scheme? Two datums. And I thought that was just an intriguing idea. I still don't completely understand it, but it's just one of those aha moments.
It's kind of right there in front of
us.
They've illustrated it very well.
And they did. Where there's
the other really surprising thing is that every one of the schemes depends upon a very big parks landscape move. That really surprised me because I thought that we would probably see a very aggressive, develop as much as possible simply because we're right on the Trinity. And it did surprise me. There is one thing that surprised me because it wasn't proposed, and I'll just tell you it. I was very surprised that no one actually talked about developing housing on the top of the levee and on the top of where this toll road is supposed to go. Because it seems to me one of the best ways to moderate between the levee and the toll road in the city is to build right over it with luxurious, wonderful housing and low-income housing too, all kinds of housing that would kind of moderate it and then would also help to engender the development that could happen behind it.
Peter?
I suppose partly surprised by the omission in some ways of this really big problem, which is this spaghetti of freeways that actually separates downtown from the Trinity River. That I suppose I might have been sort of optimistic and naive. I was expecting something to completely solve this problem. And of course nobody has. I had a kind of really big issue which challenges the three schemes. If you can't solve it, and actually it may be not possible to solve it, how do you deal with it? How do you ameliorate it? On the sort of positives, I was delighted to see what looked like a bit of Holland in Dallas from the OMA scheme, the water and this development looking like Rotterdam. Very, very interested to see the Stoss+SHOP project of driving these wedges into the city. And I almost want to say, drive them further. Let's see what happens if you really develop this and really integrate it. Really delighted with this kind of the waterfront that the Bofill scheme created. I mean, a kind of delightful space, which I can really see working. So each of the three schemes had various elements which I thought were delightful and exciting, and in many ways produced this kind of special moment.
I was surprised at what was missing. I would have thought that there would be more made as a form giver and a big central part of the plans would be public transit. They're all mentioned, but it's not a form giver. It's nothing. And I would have expected in this time to say, hey, we've got to begin, if we're going to make cities, it's got to be more on that. People mentioned DART and all that, but of making more of public transit as a form giver in the city.
Thank you. So, yes, sir. And then you, Annie, next. Yes, sir.
I just was curious because I'm not sure how familiar you are with the Dallas Summers.
Summers.
Because we like to talk about walking around the city, but it's really hot. And I'm wondering if you saw in any of the plans some sort of attempt to deal with the heat island effect or cool the city down.
So just to repeat the question, Dallas is hot. And how did the schemes help us to enjoy more without being so hot, maybe? So, Larry,
I don't know if you're familiar with the Montreal winter. But you think it's hot. I want to tell you about cold. And yet Montreal still has one of the most vibrant street lives in North America. And they acknowledge that it's designed for 7 months, and for the rest, they do something else. And that's the same message that I've been advocating in Abu Dhabi, where it's actually hotter and more humid than here, is that for 7 months it isn't. And you don't have to give up those 7 months because for a few other months it is. And you can still have that public realm and that walkability. All three schemes, though, to get back to your actual question, provided such a strong, I think one of the reasons they provided such a strong landscape scenario in their developments is that that does help moderate the heat intensity and all that of development. And that does make sense to me. And I think that's one of the reasons why that would make more sense here than in a very moderate climate city.
Anyone else like to add?
Just to go ahead.
I was going to say, actually, all three schemes incorporate shade and incorporate water. I've only been to Dallas in October and November, so I'm not the right person to comment on the summers, but I could imagine that all three would actually accommodate.
I know summer's heat. I've been to Abu Dhabi. I know summer's heat, and I know summer's cold. You know we have just finished in San Francisco our winter. You know about Mark Twain. The coldest winter he ever spent was summer in San Francisco. He was right. I'd like to be back in San Francisco right now, if only because this is when we have good weather. This is our summer. So I know, but we know about those things.
Excellent. So now, yes, Annie.
I wanted to comment on the guy's question about is the intent for the trails to connect. In 1997, the Dallas County developed and adopted a trail plan that has 500 miles of shared use paths and nature trails. And the spine for that plan is the Trinity River.
Yeah.
So it's a countywide plan connecting from the cities.
Thank you for that. And everyone, you know, Jill mentioned earlier about there's already work happening down there within and adjacent to the river to get out and ride and the like. So,
but what I don't think was in that trail system of that time and what I think needs to be added to that, not instead of that, but added to it, is as many trails as possible from downtown to the levee. I asked the studio just today if someone could just go and plot every line that you can actually make it, one way or another, even if it's horrible, from downtown, a place in downtown, to the levee and the Trinity corridor. And I suspect there's 40 of them. I haven't done the count, but I suspect if you take all of them, there could be 40 of them. If every one of those, which is now being treated pretty much as a way on or off of a freeway, but could be reconceived as a pedestrian bicycle system, you might go a long ways to at least, if not making the connection all the way to the river, at least making the connection to the land that is developable on the other side of the freeway, which then would help to enable and the real potential of that land to be developed.
You know, right now, basically, if you want to get from downtown across the river on a bicycle, you have two options. You have really one option, which is the Jefferson Street Viaduct, which has a very nice new trail on it. And then when the Continental Bridge reopens next year, that will also be available. But that's kind of it, short of, you know, putting yourself at risk with the cars on the other routes across. And every one of these schemes, and some of them don't get that fine-grained in their detail, but if you look at the number of additional connections and assume that every one of those probably includes a bike lane or a significant bike component or pedestrian component, it's many-fold now, the connection across the river and into the river that we see today, even in the current bike plan.
I'm going to mention one more, the Santa Fe Trestle Trail, which is a little further south. It's a little further south, but since we're also trying to be an advocate here to get out and bike on the Trinity, I want to make sure that's mentioned.
Well, and the Cedar Crest Bridge.
And the Cedar Crest Bridge, which is being worked.
But those
are
further down.
These are things that have happened recently and are happening now, and it's easy to just forget them because they're not sort of in our daily sort of routine. And I think Larry's challenge to just where are these and are there more that we can even make more easily available, how that can help. So, yes. Yes, ma'am.
Well, the city of Dallas right now, through our studies, has about 30% tree canopy. and 18% of that is the Great Trinity Forest.
Yeah.
And it seems to me, working in urban forestry in Dallas, that one of the connectivities, the major connectivities, not only from this area but into the city, is through our green corridors. And it would also seem to me that we have an opportunity to extend the Great Trinity Forest. And Dallas, to me, has the greatest opportunity of any city in the country to have the best urban forest. And then you start looking at your heat island mitigation, your water runoff, your water quality and quantity issues, and your energy costs. But if you start looking at this from an economic point of view rather than just an environmental and aesthetic point of view, I think it adds value, much more value, to what we would want to consider as we move forward in this area.
Janet Monnier, Texas Tree Foundation, you're going to love the schemes and their investment of trees within our connection. It is very strong from all three teams, has been mentioned. And as Allan was talking about with opportunity and others, with an opportunity beyond just the pleasure of looking and shading, but productivity that can lend itself also.
I think, though, you have to talk about where money is being spent. In my town, when we're talking about a forest station, or we're talking about a bikeway or something, we always put it in intervals of left turn bays. We say, okay, this path costs 6 left turn bays, because every year there are 50 left turn bays put in a budget. No one ever talks about them. And you might get one trail every 10 years. Well, we have to start shifting where some of that money's going so that you will start to see the implementation of these things in your lifetime rather than just one of them occasionally. I mean, it troubles me that you can count up here on this stage the number of connections. That should not be the case. You should have trouble doing that. It should take an hour and a half to do that. You know, and, oh yeah, there's another one here and another one here. That troubles me. And it has to do with where you spend money.
So with this, let's each make a sort of final comment as we'll begin to wrap up. And thank you, everyone, as being very attentive. You know, and we're right at 8:30, so let's wrap up.
Well, my final comment will just be kind of a response about the urban forest. And I think that one thing that struck me about at least two of the schemes, maybe all three, but is, you know, as we've thought about the Trinity Project and the great urban forest is an integral part of that, that 6,000 acre incredible forest, it's removed from downtown. I mean, it really only starts at the Santa Fe trestle and then goes south. And whatever we do here, it really, you know, everything we've talked about, as nice as the urban lake is, as nice as the natural lake is, they're not the forest. They will be wonderful amenities, but they're not the forest. And at least two of the schemes in their way they're presented, the Stoss+SHOP scheme and the Bofill scheme, appear to really create urban forests. So that I think there's a certain poetry about the forest being dragged up the Trinity and inserted into downtown that is different than, say, building a nice promenade or a lake or a bridge. I mean, it's just, they're shown as basically wild forest. And I think there's something intriguing and poetic about that. We really haven't talked that much about the poetry of the schemes, but I'll shut up.
Thank you, Bob. Allan?
I think it'd be nifty to look at each one of the projects, each one of the proposals, as they are now, pick one thing from each one of them that could be done in 2 months. They could start up and done in 2 months. And propose those. Get started. Simple as that. See how you like them.
Well, we have three lectures coming and three teams that are here that'll do those, and maybe we might even hear some ideas in those lectures for that.
Do something really, you know, fast, get on with it, get started. It's and so that you can see that, it came from the idea and it's we like it, and it's good. Oh, we got started. We got started.
Excellent. Peter?
While completely endorsing that, I was going to say something at the opposite end of the scale.
That's what's great working with these guys.
Say
it's a
totally endorse, but don't do it.
No. I was going to say, totally endorse it and do it, but... this is a huge site, a huge challenge, and not many cities actually have the opportunity to almost create a second downtown area next to their first downtown area. And I think that this is actually, for me, from as an outsider, far, far bigger than a single competition. This is your future, and this is going to set the blueprint for what Dallas will be like at the end of this century. And there's some really, really big issues here which are embedded around transportation, around urban form, around the use of landscape. And this is an opportunity, if you'd almost dream, with three amazing sort of illustrations of what those dreams could look like, and derive from that, and not just solutions for the connection between the Trinity River and the downtown, but actually what Dallas can aspire to be as it grows through the rest of the century. So a fantastic opportunity.
Well, for me, since I arrived, one of the big things about Dallas that struck me is there's been a kind of a massive collective denial about this area. And the thing that really pleases me about this competition and the submissions really satisfied me is that I don't think you can ever think of this area the same way again. You've got to know that there is so much that can be done. The little moves, the big moves, some of them are right off the boards that you see, and some of them are simply inspirations on those boards that will then need to be designed. The water feature, for example, needs a lot of hydrology and, you know, smart thinking. Maybe bring some of those Dutch people in for that. But you know, those things can be done, must be done, and of all the areas of Dallas, this thing that you thought was the thing to deny may actually be the thing that transforms Dallas. That, to me, is just so exciting. So those things out in that trailer that is out there, those are a glimpse of your future. Like, look at them closely.
And so I've got a couple of little things I want to share. As you saw, the gallery, which is out front. Let's see if that it's out front. It'll be in front of the DMA here for the remaining of these lectures. And then it's going to sort of bounce around or be sled around downtown and in areas. And it'll be able to be shared across different geographies. But more importantly, one of the items is that now, through this website, connectedcitydesign.com, there's now another little added photo here, and it says vote. And this is where you go to work and where all of our citizens in Dallas go to work and share their preferences. And by doing that, by voting for a professional stream idea that you prefer, voting for these hundreds of ideas that have been submitted that are also present, and so that will be taken into consideration as further discussion comes forward. As these lectures, reminder, next Tuesday night, Ricardo will be here speaking. And that will continue with our other firms. And I'm sure tonight, Kevin's making notes over there. They're going to be thinking about how to make it relevant. I know Alex has and Ricardo. So and how these ideas become more immediate. So very quickly, I would like to say there are many members here in the audience that are with the City of Dallas that work every day. They're a big part of how our city and why our city is a great city. And I'd just like for them to stand up for just a minute and be recognized, because we wouldn't be doing this challenge independently, because it just doesn't work, and they're a big part of this. And so stand up, please. David, I see you there. I see David Cossum, Teresa O'Donnell was here. There's other folks. So anyway, where's Mary Soom? So there are hundreds of people in our city that work every day that want to make our city smarter, better, and more livable. And this is a great example. So I'd like to thank my panelists, the panelists that were here and members of our jury for being from out of town in our city, for service to our city. Bob, as a local architect and designer and urban designer, thank you, Jill, for your remarks. Gail, for saying hello and inspiring us
continually, as you have, as you've really, to be quite frank, helped to birth a lot of the work that I care about and work about every day. And so with that, thank you to you, to the DMA, all of our sponsors. And please, not only visit the gallery as it's on the plaza, but go online and vote and tell us which ones you like. Please. So thank you. Good night.
Thank you for watching this video. For more information, please visit connectedcitydesign.com.